My name is Rakaya Rasnan and I'm a lecturer here at IEDE. I specialise in building performance simulation. I'd like to welcome you to today's lecture, and this is one of the IEDE Learn series lectures, which today we'll talk about wellness and wellbeing in the workplace. Our guest speaker today is Edward Garrod, who is a principal and head of sustainability at an integrated design at Elementa Consulting, which is the London arm for one of North America's biggest firms in this area, Integral Group. Ed originally trained as an architect at Cambridge and specialised in environmental design. And he's had a very long and illustrious career in this area, and he's worked in various projects in over 20 countries. At IEDE, wellbeing and global health and the issue of healthy buildings is a key focus of our work, and we have an extensive programme of work in this field. The topic of Ed's presentation today fits in very well with this area, and he'll discuss the WELL Building Standard, which was launched in 2014 with a focus on achieving superior levels of health and well-being in the workplace. I've taken up enough of your time, so please join me in welcoming Ed Garrod.
Is it possible to dim the lights a bit, just so you can see the screen a bit better? Okay, so yeah, hi, I'm Ed. I trained in architecture originally and ended up doing an environmental design course. And in those days, environmental design was very much about your physical environment. It was about thermal comfort, it was about daylight, it was about thermal delight, it was all the kind of good stuff that could help me be the very best architect and create spaces that people would feel, you know, happy and healthy. And then somewhere along the line, we started to get very, very focused on energy performance in isolation. And we're now at this interesting turning point where people are starting to ask questions about how we deal with people in the building again, going back to some of these fundamental issues around health and happiness. There's a lot of the buildings we're doing that are super low energy, there's some super unhappy people inside them. So there's a big challenge for us as an industry. So I'm part of Elementa Consulting. We're the UK arm of Integral Group. We do projects of all types. Top one over there, that's a 45,000 square metre lab building I'm doing in Doha. On track to be platinum. We also do the sustainability strategy for the whole site. We bring life back to our buildings that are struggling. Very strong connection with our colleagues overseas in America and Canada. The team that I run, we focus on six real areas of importance. And number one is actually design communication. So for those of you that see the gap between architects and engineers, how they talk to each other or don't, that's really important. That we learn each other's language, and part of that is visual. It's encouraging engineers to draw really comfortable drawing and to engage in a design conversation. We do master planning, we do a lot of performance analysis around energy simulation and so on, sustainability benchmarking you'd expect. This new area of wellness consulting, which has really only emerged in the last 6 months. And then my last remit is innovation, which is why I do this kind of thing. So it's about sharing ideas with other people outside of our own industry, but also within my company. I've got a really good team, I won't dwell on that, but all of them have got interesting backgrounds that are cross-disciplinary. I think that's one of the key things about what we're trying to achieve is getting different perspectives from different people. And they sit within a big group, and there's 20, 30 people that do sustainability and consulting for the team. These are all our offices in North America. But our CEO, who set up the company only 7 years ago, with 330 people, he was the founder of the Canadian Green Building Council, Jason McClellan. Is the guy that started the Living Building Challenge. So if you don't know the Living Building Challenge, I would heavily encourage you to look them up on the internet and find out about regenerative architecture. So buildings actually make a positive difference to society and to the environment rather than just doing less harm. Now Jason also was one of the pioneers of the World Building Standard through his role with the International Living Futures Institute. So if we wind back to why we've got excited about wellness, you can really see the roots of it in the Industrial Revolution. So we did this kind of stuff to our environment. It was the first time that we could see en masse that we could destroy our air quality, we could pollute the land, we could destroy our water quality. And people in cities like London were in absolutely terrible living conditions, and mortality rates that would shock you. And it was within that context that a lot of, if you like, enlightened self-interest is the term. It's these people with factories are thinking, how do I take my workforce away from this environment where they're dropping like flies? Put them in a much more benign environment in the country, give them access to nature, give give them access to healthcare, which in those days didn't exist, schooling for the whole family. And so you have people like Titus Salter, Soltaire, you've got Bourneville or something like this, a whole sort of background historically of companies taking it upon themselves to look after their staff, to see as organisations a responsibility to look after their people and critically to think about their health and happiness as important to their long-term success as organisations. And yet today we face a situation where we're back in the city with these sorts of problems. This is London 6-8 weeks ago, when we had a terrible pollution spell. And increasingly, because London is so expensive, we're being pushed into smaller and smaller and smaller spaces. So we're selling people the idea of being in the city is a good thing, but we're facing pollution, congestion, it's hard to get to work, and when you get there, you're in your little box. At the same time, technology is liberating us to be outside in that garden city environment of our own, in our own back garden, with access to nature, daylight, good quality environment. Obviously not with people. So we've got to make the case that the big benefit of being together in the city is social interaction. But to make that work and be a competitor to this, and this, these are real competitors to each other now, we've got to sort out some of these issues. We've got to find a way of dealing with them, mitigating them in the short term before they can be solved at a bigger scale. Every CEO of any sort of service-based company will always get up every year and they'll say, my staff are my biggest asset. And it's probably their biggest cost. A lot of the, you know, certainly in architecture and engineering, the lion's share of the cost of a company, running a company, is around people. And that's true of most service industries. And so all of these people are making the statement, but at the same time, they then put those very same staff in buildings that almost guarantee that they'll get ill and be unproductive. And if we think about the proportion of your life that you spend indoors, 80 to 90% of your work, of your life actually, not even just working life, is spent indoors. So this is your environmental context. We are outdoor animals, as some famous people have said in the past, but it's only in the last 200 years we've been inside. So your body has been genetically optimised to be outdoors, to be in contact with high levels of light, fresh air, contact with nature, and we put ourselves in these sealed environments that are, we haven't had time to adapt, there's no sort of genetic adaptation to what we've done to ourselves in the last 200 years. The impact is interesting. I mean, you can't assign all of the sick leave in buildings that happen in buildings to the buildings themselves, but it's a key statistic. So in the UK, most people have 9 days sick leave a year. Now, for the sector, in architecture and engineering, typically about 5. So there's a problem there of presenteeism. People turn up to work when they're ill and make everyone else ill. But also there are other people who are having far more than 9 days a year sick. And the cost to the economy is about £29 billion a year. That's some work that PwC did. So there's an economic driver here as well. It's not just about people's health and well-being as a social benefit, there's an economic imperative that we do something about the impact of buildings on our health, particularly when we think about health spending. Now when we're faced with these sorts of problems, the default business solution is to start talking in terms of checklists. So checklists are fantastic. Why? Because they stop planes falling out of the sky and they stop people being killed on the operating table. And there's a big mantra around this being important. And in complex activities, and design is perhaps the most complex that you can face in life. Putting a building together from scratch is a tough endeavour. And we use checklists all the time to help us get it right. The real question comes, what's on your checklist? Because it defines, it pre-limits what you care about. And the real problem that we faced in industry is that the green checklist, the likes of Brienne, Lead, these other sustainability codes, have said this is what a good building is. They define what's good, they weight the relative merits of different things, it's points-based, it defines what you want. But in terms of environmental quality, of your health and well-being, they give you only two things a guarantee. You will not suffocate in this building, at least on paper. So the specification won't make you suffocate. The system might not work because we won't check them. But you won't suffocate and no one will blow smoke in your face. You won't be exposed to tobacco smoke. Everything else is optional. That is a huge problem for us in the industry, those of us that care about green buildings, because we're selling the dream to people of buildings within which the environment will be better. So these are in green leadership and environmental design, leaders. It's giving people the hope that they'll be much more comfortable. Be a much better quality environment. If you take Lee for an example, no massive dissimilarities with Brienne. All of this good stuff, that, you know, protecting people from harm, giving people better views. I mean, God forbid you might be a situation where you expose people to toxic chemicals, but it's only optional that you should protect them. I mean, it's absolutely obscene that we have these standards for sustainability that don't offer us any higher level of aspiration in terms of our health and well-being. Now, everyone in this room, in some way or another, is a consumer of workspace. So you'll have spent time in spaces that make you feel miserable, and you'll have been in other spaces that would have made you very happy. And a lot of the work that I did in university, there was a big push around daylighting buildings in Cambridge at the time. And there was a lot of research done about libraries and where people would choose to sit in a library. And people would sit in huge environmental discomfort on paper, in sunlight, in terrible heat, but because they had a fantastic view of nature or a view of a lake. And this sort of these issues go beyond. They're complex things. But instinctively, we have a sense of what's a good place to be and what's a bad place to be. Judith Hewagen, who's a fantastic researcher in the field, did a lot of work that was then picked up by the Washington Post. And there was this sort of expose a couple of years ago. There's a big infographic. If you go to the Washington Post website, you'll find it if you Google it. And there was this like slide bar thing. You can say, well, how far am I on the spectrum of good and bad? So on this side, there's all the stuff that in America is just typical practice. You know, people working in cubicles, and buildings and VAV systems, and recirculating air. So all of that bad air is getting churned around and given back to them. They've got the boss has got the great office in the corner. They move you out. People eat at their desk because they're not given anywhere to go and take their lunch. They have a cough on each other. It's a terrible environment. That is standard. That is your baseline for most people's working lives, certainly North America, and frequently in the UK as well. And then on this side, there's all the stuff that you like. Good air, views, nature, be able to move around, maybe stand up when you're working. Those of us that are trained in architecture engineering probably from drawing boards. Little did we know how important that was for our backs, for our health in general, to be standing up. It's also about issues of control, about giving people adaptive comfort, we often term out. The ability to mediate your local environment, whether it's temperature, whether it's acoustics. Maybe it's the difference between having the right type of nature in a building and not the wrong sort. These are maintenance issues as well. It's about how people look after buildings, it's performance and use. Now what we tend to find in our culture is that when these problems happen, when you spend all that time on that side of the wall, you get ill. You have respiratory problems, you have depression, you have fatigue. And we go to our doctor and the doctor goes, that's terrible. That's really bad, here's some pills. So we medicate ourselves out of problems that we have caused as designers. We've caused as people who procure buildings. We've caused as people who manage those buildings. But the challenge for you today really is to say, well, we can do it very differently. We can prevent a lot of these problems happening through good design. And what I always say to people is that whether you know it or not, if you're involved in any way, shape or form within design or construction, you are a public health professional. Because the decisions that you make, the influence that you have, is lasting and impacts people's well-being for generations to come. The buildings that we produce are there for many, many years, and good and bad decisions have lasting impacts that really do affect people's quality of life. So as I said earlier, there's been this focus on drilling down into carbon. It's worth putting it into context. So we're talking about people and the value of people. We often find that we're asked this sort of push and pull me debate. What's more important? Is it energy? Is it people? It's a bit of a bad argument, but let's just put it into context. So if you take 1 square metre of office space in London, air conditioned, standard London office space, £28 a year to pay the energy bill. Which, this is a number that I've spent the last 15 years trying to get down from 40 to 28, really pushing hard, and we're getting to the point on that, the payback, where getting down to 26 is even harder, and the next £2 are going to be even harder still. We're fighting so hard to deliver those savings. But let's put that into some context. In that same square metre, 158 times more expensive to look after the person, to pay their wages, to pay their salary costs. If I'm a business or an organisation, and I've been told to focus on this, and all my efforts in terms of corporate social responsibility have been around energy and carbon, and I've been ignoring this, got a real problem. And we found that in the practices I've worked at before. We've done staff engagement and the sustainability requirements at fostering partners. We've done a huge amount of work on reducing the environmental footprint of the office. And when I came in, I said, let's be a bit more expansive. Let's talk in terms of best of one planet living thinking. We did this exhibition, we had all these themes around the wall, and we had fair trade wide just to let the conversation flow a bit better. And we preceded all these boards on the wall with post-it notes just to get people comfortable with the idea that they could give feedback. And what happened was almost all of the comments were around well-being, welfare, comfort. They weren't around energy, they weren't about water, because your staff expect that you should be doing that anyway. So this sort of revelation is this idea of wellness as a key issue going forward, a big trend that companies have to deal with. And it's all my fault, because I spent far too much time, and a lot of people in this room will be training to spend a lot of their time doing simulation work. And as we all know, there's a sort of rubbish out problem with simulation, but there's also a graphical issue. And that's very seductive. It says I've got numbers, it says I've got facts, you can trust me, because it's been quantified. Meanwhile, the people who've been involved with the health, the wellness debate, practitioners in hospitals, researchers in university departments, in a way like this as well, they've not been talking to each other. There's been a hesitancy about providing an evidence base. But this is certain. I mean, it's physics. You can't argue with me. This is softer, it's harder. There's a lot of problems in separating the noise from the signal when you talk about impacts on wellness. And that's exactly why the World Building Standard was developed. So what happened was there was a real estate developer in New York who was looking to develop a niche product of wellness apartments. They sell them for people. They had things like vitamin showers, some crazy stuff that's sort of slightly out there. But what they'd realised was that by digging into the detail, firstly, there wasn't a good enough evidence base around interventions in our built environment to say this will make you feel healthier or happier. But equally, once they discovered what was out there, they spent a lot of money doing this research, gathering together all of the literature reviews, you know, the standards, the peer review journals, and they realised that actually they developed this wealth of knowledge that they should share. And within that, the World Building Standard emerged. But it asked some very different things of what we should get buildings to perform. So I spent a lot of my life talking about energy, water, waste, materials, resources, all the kind of environmental impacts, how we deal with the site, how we deal with the environmental control, say. But do we ever talk about food? Food is eaten in the buildings that we design. How we design them determines how people will eat in some ways. Do we talk about fitness? How people will move around in buildings? Do we talk about whether buildings make you happy or not? Not enough. And we certainly don't ask, will you get a good night's sleep having left this building or having worked in that organisation? But these are all fundamental for us being happy and healthy people. So there we are, that's Delos, they're the people that came up with that. They made the commitment to the Clinton Foundation. So this big thing is like you go up and say, with Bill Clinton there, I make this promise to the world that I will do this good thing for the world and share it with people. And they got on stage, and it was a weird mix of people, including Will I Am. You got up there as Deepak Chopra, some real sort of characters from across the sort of show business and wellness world. But critically, they got the backing of the US Green Building Council and Jason Clements Group, the International Living Futures guys. Because normally, when you have competing sustainability standards, people start sort of clawing their eyes out. I'm the best, you're the best, yours doesn't do this, mine does that. And there just was a truce, you know. Actually, this is not being well covered by existing standards. We could do something better. And critically, they got the credibility of working with the Cleveland Clinic and the Mayo Clinic, two of the most world-renowned institutes for health and wellness. And actually, the last job I did when I was at Foster's was for the Cleveland Clinic. My sustainability client was their chief wellness officer, a guy called Michael Roizen, who's another person worth keeping. And his remit was fascinating. They worked out that as an employer of over 10,000 people, they could slash their own health insurance costs, and they're providing the healthcare for themselves, by making their staff healthy. They could reduce their exposure to sugar, they could give them smoking cessation programs, they could give people with obesity access to better fitness regimes, they could support people, and they would make money, because there's less claim on them as a healthcare provider. They started then selling that service to people they insured outside. So in America now, you can monetize wellness. It's harder for us to do that because we have the NHS as a backstop, which actually acts to subsidise all of us having good or bad lifestyles. Whereas in America, the model is slightly different. So the standard itself was put together initially by like a long list of potential interventions in our built environment. We were put together by medical practitioners first. They were asked to look at what is possible, what's been peer-reviewed, what are the papers that have been published, what do you see in medical practice that tells you there's an issue we should talk about. That was then filtered down by practitioners. So people in architecture, people from these guys. So there's some heavyweight players in there. And you'll notice the likes of Google in there. their staff don't cost £4,500 per square metre, it's probably £40,000 per square metre. So the cost of productivity loss and unhappiness to them is huge. So a small investment in health and wellbeing could reap big rewards. And then the great thing for us as an organisation, which is this guy Eric here, he's our managing principal in Oakland, out in California. He was the only engineer involved in developing the standard. So we've had a bit of an inside track there. What's important to know as well, this isn't just a design and construction approach. It's about organisations coming together with the buildings that they occupy. And that means asking the clients that we work with to make really big commitments to staff welfare. And you cannot be a well-certified building unless you actually are an organisation that looks after the welfare of its staff. So it's finally bringing together that kind of change management and organisational piece of the buildings that we work with. Because too often good ideas don't get followed through because the people that occupy those buildings haven't shared that vision, they don't understand how the building's meant to operate, and then certainly they don't necessarily look after their staff. So it's a well building with a well organisation. And the process of making that happen starts with the design shred. So this is standard practice in North America. I don't know how many people here are used to the term, even. Basically, it's a posh name for a workshop. But what critically happens on a well project is that you have to have senior people from the company involved. So you're talking about C-suite people. It's funny, when you start talking about productivity, sick leave, happiness, staff retention, it's not just the project manager for that fit out or the project manager for that new building that turns up. It's the CEO, it's the head of HR. And they can then come in and work with you to develop a wellness vision. So what are the things that matter to that organisation to help transform it from one that's not as healthy or happy as it should be to one that could be a lot more effective in those areas? And then we ask those same clients to commit to, in big picture terms, giving people better air, protecting their staff from exposure to bad materials, materials that might damage their health. So it's a precautionary approach. Giving them access to cleaner, tastier, more accessible water so they don't get dehydrated. And making sure that they have, as best as they can, access to good quality lighting and contact with nature. And then getting into how they run their businesses. They have to commit to look after their staff. And some of these things are optional, some are required. But for example, if you ask the staff to travel around the world, take red-eye flights, should you really expect them to get off the plane and go straight into a meeting? Probably not, if you care about looking after them. If you want your staff to be happy, you should be subsidising a gym membership. If you want them to be resting, maybe you can give them a place to sleep and a place to eat together. But all these things are about opportunities rather than forcing people to do it. It's not the kind of, we must do this together, you will get fit, you will stop smoking. It's giving people opportunities. It's very much grounded in nudge theory. Changing people's behaviours by giving them an easier route with less friction, if you like, to make better choices for their lifestyles. And it's quite lucky that I've got my green coat here instead of my red coat. We often find that our clients are drip feeding their staff drinks that will give them diabetes. So the well stand says you cannot have more than 35 grams of sugar in a single serving. That means you cannot have cans of Coke in your dispensing machine. That is absolutely wrong. You must not sugar your staff up to the point where they're going to probably come back to you in 20 years' time with a class action saying, I'm obese, I've got diabetes because of you. You put this in front of me, I couldn't resist. You made me an addict. And funny enough, after I did a presentation at the clinic, I was really dehydrated, I was really tired, really jet lagged, I'm desperately searching out a place to get a can of Coke. And I burned up more calories than I could have consumed anyway, just trying to find one, to only find out you cannot find any sugar drinks at all in the whole of the Cleveland Clinic campus in America. And it's at that point you realise that you've become an addict. It's a funny sort of moment when you cannot have access to a sugar drink and you think you need it, you don't need it. And you've become programmed. And that's the scary thing about what we're doing to our lives. The building makes an impact. If you give people the opportunity to have access to some of these things that have been made ill, as an organisation, you're facilitating that addiction. Strange way of thinking about it. But also how you give them food, how you encourage them to move around the building. And then asking, does it work? We do so much work, you know, you haven't done it tonight, and get quick at that before someone sees us because it didn't work. Why not find out, do post-occupancy evaluation. This is an absolute requirement under the WELL standard that you will use the UC Berkeley comfort assessment process they use, which is, goes some way beyond what the Bill Wallace and Adrian Lehman have done with the probe studies. But very much, you know, that approach is in there. What it does, though, is it builds up a database of these buildings, how they perform over time. So twice a year, post-occupancy evaluation of these buildings, every year. So you're gathering data about how these buildings are performing, and then you've got a database, then you've got an open space to talk about, do well buildings perform better than the existing database of just average buildings? Do you keep maintenance records? Can you show me that that filters and that have been changed in the last 6 months? Probably not, probably somewhere actually. Same with the cleaning. And do you tell your staff, do you keep them informed of how the building's being maintained? And the standard has a very different approach to tracking performance. So if you're used to things like Lean and Brian, where it's impact based, it's actually based on these concepts. It's a hierarchy of needs. So there's a word that I got from Westland, it's a hierarchy of needs back in the 1960s. It's modeled on that, in essence. So the principle is that you cannot start talking about health and happiness, real, you know, sort of satisfaction in life, unless you've got some of these other things underpinning it. And to quote Bear Grylls, it's 3 minutes without air, you're dead. 3 days without water, 3 weeks without food. So you've got to get those right. You can't expect people to be high performance in high performance buildings if they've got bad air, bad water, and they're being given junk food. And it's only then you start really worrying about, is the lighting good? That we'd probably spend more time worrying about the daylight and allowed all these bad things to happen. And getting people moving around, comfort, so thermal, acoustic and so on, and then talking about real mental health. You need these things to be linked together, but there's these fundamentals you've got to get in place. And as a result, there's a real emphasis in the Welsh standard on getting these ones right. This is when you can see how the doctor's impacted it. So they say, let's not talk about metrics of so-and-so, this, meter square. No, let's talk about the body systems that are affected by the decisions that you're making. So if someone says to you, sitting on that chair will expose you to this chemical, which will do this to your immune system and might make you fertile, it's a different conversation. And it's very personal. So we all go, we all assess ourselves, we're very aware of our own bodies and our own mortality. And we know that we are a machine that we have to look after. So if designers are given a toolkit which allows them to think about their actions in terms of their health impacts, maybe they will make different decisions. So when we talked about all the things that LEED looked at in terms of environmental quality, there's about 10 on this slide, if you remember. The Welsh standard is about 100 big ideas. So you've, in a factor of 10, increased the conversation. Some of them are blindingly obvious things, but the thing about them is they're now on the checklist. So the question gets asked, do you do this? Do you look after your staff? Do you provide maternity care? What these sorts of issues get considered. And for each of these features, there are then parts, you know, little things you have to get to make them come together. And every single one of those then has a peer-reviewed evidence base. So when I go in now into a room with a client, and I make the case for desks that you can stand at, I can talk to a piece of, you know, peer-reviewed evidence. Before that, if I start saying, oh, who are you? You're not a doctor, you're not a physiotherapist. And this gives us credibility to have these conversations. Now, it's a business as well for them, so this is certification, and that's how these things work. You're paying to be certified, you're paying for the building to be registered. You're also paying for it to be commissioned. So the wellness commissioning, you have to demonstrate in practice that the building has the air quality that you're aiming for, the water quality and so on. And an important part is that there's this idea of a precondition. So within most sustainability standards, there'll be a minimum requirement. Safe energy, you must be 10% better than this benchmark value. Otherwise, you can't be in the path. But a third of the requirements within WELL are absolutely non-negotiable, mandatory. So it sets a new baseline. And if you don't conform to that baseline, you don't get a rating. You can get a number out of 10, but you're not going to get a badge. So it sets a different threshold of what's acceptable. It really does raise the bar of what is normal and good for a building. And beyond that, you then have these optimizations, things that you can choose to do that will make your environment healthier and happier. So you start winning the higher prizes, if you like. But the real focus is these preconditions, these fundamental requirements. And that makes it really hard. So when we look at comparing the performance of projects that have got BREEAM ratings, you know, really high BREEAM ratings, they do terribly against the World Building Standard. And that's part of this checklist blinkered approach, because it wasn't something you had to talk about, it wasn't considered. So there is nothing you can say about mold growth on the air handling units, because no one's thought about it, because no one was asked to think about it. And that's the reality of design, unfortunately. But a lot of the decisions you can make are cost neutral. They're just conscious effort to think about how people will occupy and be using a building. to give you some sense of some of the ideas, I'm going to go through each of those seven concepts with some examples. So, natural ventilation, good thing, bad thing? Almost unanimously, good thing? Happy with that? Okay, so, but what about the air quality? So I spent the whole of my education being told natural ventilation. You go into practice and a naturally ventilated building would come along once every 3 years because we end up sealing them up. Because natural ventilation is really hard, actually. But the bigger issue is what's the quality of the air. So Derwent is a very enlightened developer in London. He's doing some new buildings around Old Street. And they've all got opening windows, so hooray for natural ventilation, but do you really want to breathe in that air? Now in 10 years time, 20 years time, London will have probably fantastic air. But right now, would you really want to be sitting next to Old Street roundabout with a window open? Actually, these windows open. Breathing that in, day in, day out, it's not good for you. So well open will only allow you to do natural ventilation if you've got good air quality inside. Then in terms of material safety, so again, the living building challenges are one of the reference points, as well as cradle to cradle. It's done on brand standing, there's this health product declaration that are in the new version of the. And really they're about understanding the ingredients, what things are made of. So if I asked you, what is your chair made from? Would you know? And how would you know? And would you know if those chemicals in that chair are bad for you or good for you? Or nothing to worry about? I haven't got any idea. There's probably some suspicion that something might not quite be right, something that we wouldn't like. But what about if you had a simple screening mechanism? So the Living Building Challenge uses what's called the Red List. So the red list says, here are lots of materials that we know cause cancer, cause toxicity to our environment, but also the planet as a whole. And there's also all these other ones that we're not sure about, but we think might be a bit dodgy. Now, do you want them in your building? Probably not. I was working on that project in Doha, and the client, we were with a client in Elementa, doing a presentation, the architect spoke as well. Their sustainability lead got up and said, now, are you okay if we don't put anything in this building that would give you cancer? Are you okay if we don't use those materials? And the client was like, what on earth are you talking about? Why on earth would you as an architect put something in my building that could make me ill? I was like, okay, great. So we'll sign up to the red list today. Yeah, okay, fine, I'm not going to do that. Normally what we do in design is we sell the problem. So we say, look, we could screen out these materials, but it's going to cost you this much in fees because I've got to do extra research. It's going to be hard to get the supply chain a bit. It might cost more. Gone, you know, it doesn't happen because we're not selling the benefits, we're not talking about the impact that it has on our day-to-day lives. And then going back to the idea of water, so well standard optimization, are you within 30 metres of a drinking fountain or a water point workspace? I was on a panel a couple of weeks ago and there was a lady who'd done a lot of research in call centres. So you think this is kind of like, it's easy, I can go and get a drink. But if you're in a call centre and you have a 10-minute break and it takes 5 minutes to get to the drinks point, and 5 minutes to get back, and that's your chance to go to the toilet as well, what are you going to do? You don't drink. Your productivity goes down. It's in these environments where simple changes like giving people access to water, you can really track their productivity boost, because these guys are being tracked all the time. It's something we should all do. We should all be hydrating much more. And in terms of food, could you grow food in the building? Give people access to understanding where food comes from, because we've become a bit disconnected. Could you give people a quick express checkout route for the good stuff? Maybe have to wait a bit longer for the other stuff. They even do that in IKEA now. You go to IKEA, there's an express checkout for the salads. If you want your meatballs and gravy, slightly longer. And in America, big issue around serving sizes. Can you ask for a smaller serving that will cost you less? So that rather than the default option being huge amounts of food, can you have a smaller portion? And we give people a place to eat together. So most offices in London now just say, look, we're not going to, it's not our problem. You can go outside, there's Costa over there, off you go. The result is people eat at their desks. So they're sort of dining al desco, as they call it. The problem is, if you eat on your own, unsupervised, not to make it too big, rather, you will eat more, you'll eat less healthily, but critically, you won't have the social interaction with your peers. So you don't get the mental health benefits, and you're giving yourself more food and less healthy food. Find that when people come together to eat, it has a big impact on the quality of their diet and their mental health. So how many people here check their phone before they go to bed? Okay, right? So you just bathed your face in blue light, really bright blue light. Do you know what blue light does to you? It wakes you up. So your whole body, I mean, we are tuned to be outside, and for millennia we've been used to getting up to blue light, that light becoming a bit more white, and then it goes down to being much more orange in the evening. And your body is primed to respond by being alert and then we're sleeping. And we are messing with our heads with the quality of light. We care far too much about the absolute amount of light that you get, so thinking about lux levels, rather than thinking about the lux that your body sees as well. It's not just about your eyes, it's about your skin. So this concept of melanopic lux, simulating for what your skin sees, not just how much light you get, is something to think about. And you've got manufacturers now that are coming out with different types of tunable white light. So these lights could be very, very subtly shifting from that blue spectrum towards the red spectrum throughout the day, or even being tweaked a little bit so that after lunch dip and attentiveness could be compensated for with maybe a little bit more blue light. So there's a market that's coming and the technologies are there to be used. When you come into a building, what's the first thing you see? Is it the lift? Is it the stairs? If you want people to be active, make the stairs exciting, make them interesting, make them pleasant. Don't make it the fire escape that's damp, not heated, dark, the lights only come on and they flicker. If you really want people to move in a building, you've got to make the stairs something you celebrate. Something that we did at Mazda. So the project I did in Abu Dhabi, when you come into this building, the stairs are the most wonderful things. And the lifts are tucked away. It's all compliant with disabled access issues. But you make the default choice, the exciting choice, the choice that will get your heart moving. And the reason we did it there was that in the Middle East there's a widespread, it was basically an epidemic of inactivity and diabetes as a result of it. Getting people moving when they're used to sitting in an air-conditioned car, going to an air-conditioned desk, going back to an air-conditioned apartment, going back to an air-conditioned house, no walking involved at all, it has an obvious impact on people's health and well-being. So funnily enough, these sorts of things start making us talk about microclimate. So when you talk about how you move around buildings, how can you create a microclimate that's more walkable, that's more enjoyable? And that means talking about outside too. Can you create environments, if you have the luxury of a landscape around your building, within which people will choose to find a place for peace, a place for reflection, an opportunity to go and walk? If outside isn't fun to go and walk around, simple things like putting the running track in, making the route interesting, people will walk more. If they walk more, it's going to have impacts, beneficial impacts on their health. This is a new craze that is not going to go away. Standing desks. I talked to you earlier about working in drawing boards. About 50% of our office in Oakland, in California, now work standing up. So you're finding the cost of standing desks, adaptable high desks, has gone from £2,000-£3,000 a piece for the motors, down to about £500. Now, if you're in office and you've got a member of staff, £500 of lost productivity is like a day's worth of wages, really, to you. So if someone is happier working at height and they've been doing this all day, it's not actually that hard to make an economic case for it. And we find that there's a huge movement towards this idea of flexible height. So it can be either your desk moves or that you can choose to work somewhere else at a different height. And in doing that, you gain core body strength. And the feedback we get from our colleagues in the States is that it's about 3 weeks of agony as your body realigns and all the muscles come together. And then after that, people never go back to sitting. They just prefer to stand working up. Sorry, work standing up. But also the freedom to move around. So if you have this situation like we have in London where space is at a premium and your desk is what's smaller and smaller and smaller, do you compensate by giving people different spaces and different work styles that they can enjoy? Places that they can go that are different acoustic characteristics, different privacy. And back to those sleep pods. People normally think, yeah, that's rubbish. I get clients asking for these all the time now because they have workforces that come in from New York. They need to recharge, they need to be on top performance, and it's no longer seen as a taboo to actively sleep in your workplace. It's going to improve your performance. This isn't just nodding off your desk, it's purposefully taking a break and recharging your batteries. So as I said, we were involved as a company in the early days of the standard, and actually we wrote the auditing procedures for it. So when WELL buildings are certified on now, they're using a set of measures and processes that we invented as a company. And that means going into workspaces with equipment that's too expensive to own, so you want to hire it. It's talking about the quality of light, the spectrum of the light, measuring formaldehyde levels, really getting into detail of acoustics and air quality. It's kind of kit that gets used. And one of the first buildings that we were involved in the audit of was a pilot project in San Francisco. So San Francisco has a fantastically temperate climate, perfect for natural ventilation. So these buildings were all designed with air-cooled windows. And then humans being what they are, we discovered air conditioning, we sealed the whole thing up, and then the obvious happens, people get a bit upset. So on this building, on this floor plate, stripped it right back. So the paint was chiselled away from those sealed up windows. They were opened up. People were given access to control of the blinds. What a revolution that is, to let people to control that environment. Even, oh my word, control valves on the regulators, you can turn them off. Now in America, this is unusual. And our colleagues in the States are like, we put in TRVs. And we're like, yes, well done. But it's a, you know, it's different in different parts of the world. So what you find is this floor plate, everything here that isn't coloured up in a zone, is naturally ventilated all the way through here. And that changes things massively. So it's only those areas with very high local loads that have air conditioning that they have to tolerate. And then these little blue circles, that's where the fans are put in. Now, those of you who know your comfort theory know that if you increase your air movement, you can have about an extra 2 degrees of range of comfort by having increased air movement. So a naturally ventilated environment can perform that extra 2 degrees worth of output, if you like, with some fans. We've totally forgotten that in environmental design. I don't know why, but this seems to drop off the agenda. But these are really good. These are by a company called the Big Ass Fan Company. They've got the best name for a fan company I've come across. And that fan is 3 times as energy efficient as standard fans in the same output, and it's virtually silent. Architects like that. But it's a key thing, that's these sort of transitional technologies between that bin and fully cooled buildings is something that we tend to forget about. So here's what it's like inside. So you can see a lot of features that you would think of as well. You've got plants in that environment, you've got space to break out and have conversation. You've got kitchen facilities that are easily accessible, places to eat with each other. You've got a boardroom, yeah, with abundant daylight, glare-free lighting, and natural materials. You've got plants in the environment. Again, this is San Francisco, so there's a terror of dirt or earth because it's full of bacteria. So if you have that problem, there's always a workaround, so those are air plants. If you're determined to get nature into your building, you can always do it. And these breakout spaces and the different type desks, the ability to choose the free address, the idea that you can choose how or where you work. Still relatively high density of occupation. So that's all well and good for everyone else, but what did I do? What have we done as a company? There's no point me standing up here and saying this is great if we don't try ourselves. So we work in this building here. So Briamex. It's a fantastic building on paper. Very well, I shall leave it. The problem is that actually the environmental quality itself is not good. The shading doesn't work very well. The energy systems are uncommissionable, and we are a tenant of that building. I am on a floor of MEP engineers who are not allowed by the landlord to fix the building on their own. Well, that is sort of ultimate torture for mechanical engineers. When I joined the company, we had about 20-25 people in that space. We've grown the last year, we're almost 40 in the same space. And what we did as an initial mission was we found a service office space around the corner, and it's costing us £13,000. Them around dropped pretty quickly. So they were away from us. So socially this sort of isolated. It was also really damn expensive. We thought we actually got to bring these people back into the fold. We've got to get them back into our way of working. But to do that we had to squeeze people into ever smaller space. So how would we do it without people leaving? So good engineers are like hen's teeth, which is a very good advert for being an engineer if you're thinking of a career. But if you're good at that job, finding those people is incredibly expensive. Retaining them is incredibly hard. Motivating them even there's always someone looking for that good person to go and work in their firm. Because we don't train well enough. That's the biggest problem in our industry. We do not have throughput of good engineers, particularly in the UK. So it's a big risk to us doing this, squeezing people in, worrying about people leaving. So we did our own wellness assessment. How would our space rate? We were a factor 1 out of 10 on that metric. So you've got all the 7 concepts, what you have to do, what you can do if you really want to, what's our overall score. But the rating system is really mean. If you don't meet the preconditions, you get a low score. So there's a few things we did quite well, but we only get rewarded to a certain level because we didn't hit all the points. So epic fail. This is a BRIAM excellent building, remember? So this is not something you can just tack on to a standard high performance building. Now, if we could do everything possible, technically feasible, where could we get to? We could only get up to a 3. And that's part in part, so for example, on the air, we're still a 1. We don't control our air handling unit. We don't control the quality of the air that we get. We are an environment. We are surrounded by building sites. God only knows how many come up before. The particulate levels might be in the air that's coming into my workspace that I cannot control. And Wells says that's just not good enough. So it's pretty depressing. But if you break down into those features, you remember I said there was 102 things, 257 features? Well, if you break it down into those component parts, that's your optimizations, these are your preconditions, and then the grey out across the seven themes: air, water, nourishment, light, fitness, comfort, and mind. Where we were achieving when we did this first check. Now, doing everything we possibly could, that's where we get to. So there's a significant scope for improvement. Using the standards framework to inform those design decisions. But life is expensive and short and all the rest of it, so you have a limit of time and money. We had a £20,000 budget to do this work, to squeeze these people in. So what did we do? We did what Well asked us to do, to do a charrette. Sit together, ask what people care about. What are the problems in that space? It's too bloody loud. You've got your acoustic baffles up here. We don't have any. We've got an exposed thermal mass ceiling. Great in terms of energy consumption doing. Terrible in terms of acoustics. We had no layout space. We had nowhere to eat together. We had a galley kitchen with a small table about this big. At 12:15, the early party would get there, they'd secure the turf and make sure that no one else would sit there whilst they laughed loudly. Make sure don't come near my table, I'm not moving. So everyone else just ate at the desk where they left it was. People wanted to eat together. Staff that came in from our office workers felt really unwelcome. There was no one for them to touch down, we wanted to learn together. So these aren't necessarily directly health and wellness things, but they're around sort of environmental quality. Wanted to be motivated and happy in the workplace. Now I had no choice but to intervene acoustically, and I got myself some expensive headphones. And my friend Jason McClellan, our guy from the Living Building Challenge, has this principle, which is ask yourself, if everyone did the same as I did, would the world be a better place? So in the design practice, if everyone deals with the guy over there who's too loud, by going, do you have a meaningful design practice? Destroys collaboration. And you can think of that as the example he uses on biomass. So if everyone burnt biomass, would the world end up being a good place? It's pretty clear to think, well, no, we can't handle the forest, the air quality would be terrible, not a good thing. So, question, on that basis, should you be burning biomass at all? So the Living Building Challenge, for example, has a ban on combustion. Worth thinking about. So we didn't do that alone, we actually used a furniture solution. So we started articulating how we can improve our space in terms of the World Building Standards. So by creating these two little booths, we transformed our little reception area where people come and sell us stuff, sit on uncomfortable chairs, but no, let's make that another space for ourselves. We're desperate for space to meet with each other. But we needed to be, it used to be private, so we can give a lot of benefit by having this furniture solution. And if you haven't tried one, go to one of the showrooms, pretend you've got lots of money, and you'll see the huge difference in your acoustic environment by being in these sheltered spaces. But ultimately, the solution for us was actually about flexibility and adaptability, both the personnel and the furniture. So we had these huge grand, this board table that was very expensive for them. And they made another meeting table, a big oval. There's nothing you could do with them. They were fixed. They took up space. And if you didn't want them there, then just tough luck, that's what you had. So we just transformed it by investing in some flexible desks. And this is Doug, who's my boss. And he had a fantastic corner office, very big. Really great views over South London. And we said to him, look, we're only in the office 2 days a week. You need to take one for the team. So how does hot desking sound to you? He said, okay, if you think it's the right thing to do. So he vacated our office, and that galley kitchen was transformed into this, which is the heart of our office now, where we can have around 15, 18 people who have lunch together with really easy access to food. So we've gone from that squeezed galley kitchen to a place where people come together. There's a couple of vegans on my staff, and bit by bit you can see the impact of people trying things they wouldn't try, and people frowning when they come in with a really big cheesy spaghetti thing, like, really, you're eating that? So the dialogue around nourishment happens because you create a space for it. And that space can't just be a kitchen for us because we have no space. So it's also our layout space. It's also the space where we can break out into separate meetings. It's a space within which you can do work standing up. So the factoid here is that if you work standing up for a week, you burn the same calories as running a marathon. So that normally gets people asking for a standing desk. It's a huge impact on your calorie burn. So to be up and mobile and walking around rather than sat. And the big mantra in America, when they launched the standard, they had all sorts of speakers coming up. And it was this thing, sitting is killing you, and sitting is the new smoking. People got up off their feet and started applauding. And in America, this is where it's going, and it's true. And the question will be, in the future, why did we spend so much of our life sat down and doing bad things to our bodies by not moving for 8-9 hours at a time? You're going to do it on a plane, people worry about deep brain thrombosis. Most of us do it 40 hours a week without blinking. And that space then is also the space that we learn together. So everything folds away, packs up at the back, and we can now learn together. And that proves that engineers smile. Not all of the water faces are struggling, but we can do it. And when you have good design ideas, and you think this was a good design idea, lots of things happen that you don't plan for. That's the beauty of people, is that you can't tell them what to do, but they will find a way. So we didn't have a fitness mantra on this job. We weren't thinking about exercise. But when you get those tables and you put them into a group before, someone worked out that just needed a net and the orange balls are much easier to be seen. Well, that came back out. And last Christmas, within a week of being up and running, we would have our own table tennis round robin competition. So at 6:30, most newbies. Is there any? Having people do round the world is quite a challenge in an office space. But it makes people happy. So we went from an office that was squeezed, it was miserable, it was separated. We spent a relatively small amount of money. It paid for itself within 6 weeks. Not a single member of staff has complained or worried about their working conditions, even though we have squeezed people in. People are a lot happier, they're a lot healthier. And in a way, that well framework has given us this new context, a new language to talk about, and it helps us hugely engaging with staff. And why we've done this and why we actually care about them. So, thank you very much, and I'm worried.
Well, thank you very much, Ed, for your presentation. Before I kind of hand over to Ed for questions, I'd like to mention that in recognising the importance of work in this field, we're considering launching an MSc in Healthy Buildings or Health and Wellbeing in the built environment soon. We would welcome any feedback or any views you might have, especially from industry participants today, about whether this is an area of interest for them and what they would like to see in terms of skills attainment for people who might sign up to this program. The person leading this initiative is my colleague, Dr. Marcella Ucci, who's sitting there, so please feel free to kind of go and chat with her about any ideas you might have. I've also left some of her business cards by the desk over there, which also have the leaflets about the programs we run at IEDE. So I'll hand over to Ed for any questions you might have.
Thank you. In the like San Francisco, the United Tech's firms and yep. Some movement for like opening spaces that where people just don't really have a fixed, their own fixed places.
Yep.
It's not really, really the dichotomy between your own space, but fixed place, but that kind of place and your own desk. But would you be generally considered better to have that kind of space in general? Like,
it honestly depends on your work style. I think the main thing is you never should force someone. So you should provide the opportunity. Now, you see a lot of London consultancy offices now have a system where you'll come in and you'll have a locker. And in your locker will be your laptop if you didn't bring it in with you. And there may be a sort of central shrine where you have your pictures of your kids and you go and get your picture of your kids and you go to the desk that's free. And for those of you who have seen W1A, the comedy about the BBC, about fight for air, he said, those spaces have a lot of problems with people being forced to fight for space. And some people are very territorial. And for some people that's really important about their identity. So I think the important thing is choice. And you'll remember when we used to work together that the trauma about an office move where we'd have to reassign teams and move people around. Remember Barry? We had an engineer called Barry who would never move. And so he was like this, he was the sun in our universe, and the whole office would re-move around him because actually it just wasn't worth the hassle. For this guy who was a really good draftsman engineer, it wasn't worth forcing him to deal with the sort of the emotional tear of moving from his space. So you've got to be adaptable. I think the interesting thing is this emphasis on collaboration space. And that's the trade-off we're seeing, is that people have a smaller space within which to work, because you don't need lots of space for paper anymore. You need a place to do stuff and be quiet. But you need different types of space for different activities. not be worried about disturbing other people. And so it's this working landscape. So rather than the battery chicken sort of scenario where everyone has the same cubicle, everything is the same, you transition into this world where it's much more flexible and adaptable.
How do we increase wellness in building from year to year? We put a lot of effort then into construction and a huge amount of money, and then we tend to forget management of the building after that.
But there's a problem in the UK, and it's global, with most commercial fit out. You have a 5-year break clause in your contract. So after 5 years, you can leave. So what happens is after that first year, people start saying, well, we might be leaving in 2 or 3 years' time, don't fix that. And then they get to 5 years and they decide to stay and they just paint something, because it's only another 5 years till we might be leaving. The way that the World Building Standard tries to deal with that is, firstly, it's a mandatory requirement for continuing post-occupancy evaluation. But it also says that this badge that you can work really hard to achieve, if you go for WELL certification, only lasts 3 years. So you can't demonstrate that performance is being maintained, you lose it.
And how frequently does it need to be?
Every 3 years.
So, but you said that it has to be...
So the most occupancy thermally, in terms of, you know, sort of general, what we'd understand as environmental comfort, acoustics, lighting and so on, is twice a year, so you're capturing the heating season and the cooling season, mm-hmm. And you need to gather the data and share it with the staff every year. So it's forcing people to be a bit more transparent about what they're doing and they're doing.
And then everything else is measured every year?
Not everything. Some things are static. Some things are inherent to the way something was designed. But the truth is, the protocol for how they're going to recertify, they're not there yet. They've really just got the first buildings through the pilot phase, and under the 3 years old, ready to go into that next maintenance, you know, ongoing maintenance stage. But the key thing is asking people to keep records. So too often, we were asking our building, where are the filter maintenance records for our air handling unit? You should be able to tell us, Mr. or Mrs. Landlord, that you're keeping my air quality up and running. They don't. Very few firms, very few facilities management companies keep the data on good, well-run buildings. Yes, they do, but on very many they don't. So this is another stick, if you like. It's one way of asking that right question, but also institutionalising the process by which facilities management for a company would be asking for that data. And by doing that, you can start to change the way that we work.
So this is also often done on the business case, that your staff health, productivity,
yeah,
wellness, satisfaction will improve. So is the WELL standard, in fact, primarily capturing satisfaction? And is it attempting to cover productivity, health outcomes at all?
So it's a difficult one, because you'll know that it's so complex how these factors interact. So if you want to say something, completely and say, well, is it better or not? In a completely controlled situation, these kids are in the classroom with no light, these kids are in the classroom with light, you might be able to make some definitive answers. We know from work that was done in time and motion studies back in the 60s that just painting a room makes people's productivity go up, forget the VOCs, right? But it makes the productivity go up because they feel like someone cared, that they matter. So separating the signal from the noise is really tough. And I think that's where this post-occupancy evaluation becomes critical, because it gives this consistent data set over time to make these claims more forceful. But I would never go to a client and say, I guarantee you'll get better productivity. What we find is that most people intuitively, when they look at the standard, go, yeah, of course, yes, that, yes, obviously, mine, yes, definitely. So there's an acceptance that it makes sense on an intuitive level.
So there's a question about self-reported productivity that is asked every 3 times a year or something?
But equally, we have clients where we haven't worked on the Use the World Building Standard necessarily. We did a fit out for Allied World Assurance, which is an insurance company that are in the walkie-talkie building. And so we did a fit out for them, and it's very focused on quality of life and looking after their staff. And they went from a building that was in the lower levels of the Gherkin up to this floor 28, and a much more open environment, much higher quality of facilities. They saw their absenteeism drop by 40%, and they found that they were able to hire staff at lower salaries than their competitors because people wanted to work in that building. Now that's anecdotal, as all of these things are, and that's the real problem that we face. So what the WELL standard does, it doesn't take away that problem of things being, the data set being debatable. What it does is it provides useful metrics, useful evidence base. So we can say that this has been looked at by lots of different people, by people with credibility in the field, who said this is something that you can use to make a case. And that makes our lives a huge amount easier dealing with these people. But I think the biggest thing is that when you talk to the CEOs and the HR guys, they do come back with our people are our biggest asset, and they know that they've got problems. They know they've got absenteeism problems. They know they've got health and mental health issues with their workforces, and they know that it's affecting their profitability. Because their HR departments have this data, but they are not going to share it. So it's a struggle making. You don't want to go to someone and say, oh, you'll get 0.2% improvement. But the truth is, the scale is so huge that, you know, that relative cost of rent or energy versus your salary cost, people recognise that a small investment that can have tangible benefits pays for itself quite a bit. The biggest challenge, though, is moving from CapEx to OpEx. So you're swapping budgets. So you're asking for the HR manager to take the budget for COVID, making people sick, and transfer it into design and construction to make people well. And that's why that first design session where those important people are around the table is so critical.
Also, it sounds that this might work better for all occupied buildings.
Absolutely. I mean, having said that, there's three versions. There's core and shell, which is just if you like well ready. So you design the shell of the building so that someone can come in and do a fit out that could be fitted out by an organisation that would be a well organisation. Then there's a tenant improvement, like fit out, standard and new construction. But it's definitely, you know, the business is owner-occupied, really. The real results are for owner-occupiers. But we are seeing buildings in London where we've done work for tenants coming in, where lots of very famous buildings in London will not meet the well standard, because you cannot get the right amount of air in, you can't give people access to good water. And there's a risk that those buildings become stranded assets. That's the big economic driver. So if I'm a speculative developer, and I don't create the environment within which a high-performance client from North America, mainly at the moment, can come and occupy my building and get well certification, you've got a problem. So the value of those properties will decrease as not being capable of being raised to this standard. We're already seeing that.
Question about the research. You know, it's mainly based on American standards, so
yep.
Sometimes a bit more difficult and pricey to implement it in the UK. So, do you think this standard will have similar problems in the UK?
It will, yeah. And the thing is, the truth is that there's a lot of talk about LEED not being applicable outside of the US because of those standards, but actually, there are so many international alternative compliance paths that are provided now that with very few exceptions, you can use the British standards to go through it. People just assume you can't because you have to do the hard work of finding out where that footprint is, the precedent has already been set. Now, the guys that are running the World Building Standard, it's the International World Building Institute, consciously the international rather than the US or Canadian. And they've been, they've launched in China, they've launched in Qatar, interestingly two places with China, terrible air pollution issues. But actually the air pollution within buildings is even worse because most of the systems are recycled and actually concentrated pollutants within buildings. And then Qatar, where they've got real problems of diabetes and air quality as well. So they have very different code environments. The standard will be adapted. So the big difference you'll find between North American rating systems and the UK is that if you say, can you change this? They go, yeah. If it meets the intent, why not? If you ask the same with the BRE, someone goes, no, no, no. They call it Dr. No 1 and 2, 3, to Dr. No, no, and it just keeps going. It's a very different service-oriented in North America. And they want the standard to be adopted as widely as possible. So if we find on projects that it doesn't work in the UK because of a standards issue, we email them and they go, okay, well, we'll consider that. And they're generally pretty flexible. The key thing is, have you met the intent? That's what always should be that way with these sort of systems. If you're doing what you can do and it's equivalent, who cares what the standard is? It's how you deliver the result.
How many projects do you think are currently pursuing the certification? I know there's one certified, the CBRE Los Angeles.
Yeah, so they've got, if you go to wellcertified.com is the website, they've got a whole host of projects now that have gone through the pilot program. Mm-hmm. We're working at the moment on about 200,000 square foot of office space in London that's looking at the well standard. Not all of it will go through certification. So my point earlier about, for me, it's a framework, it's a tool. So we work with, one of the clients we work with, we take them through the process. They cannot get certified for various reasons to do with the base build. Core and shell won't let them do it. But they've taken everything that we've done, all the measures that we've suggested in that process, and they take through everything they can do. Because they want a wellness narrative to talk to their staff about. This is what we have done for you, my staff, to do the best we can for you in the work environment. But in London, I mean, everyone's keeping a secret. I would say it's probably in the days, weeks, or most months before someone launches claims to be the first well project in the UK. And the frustration will be for a firm like us that we've been doing projects and using it for a long time, and none of our clients have yet hit that button. So it's, you can only be first once, but it shouldn't be too competitive about this.
On the commercial side, what do you think the business potential is for this? If you look coming at it from an Elementa's perspective.
So for us, so at the beginning I said that one of my hats is innovation. So I'm, one of my remits is to take ideas from North America and just throw them into the mix in the UK and see whether they float or not. And equally, we send ideas back from Europe, back to North America, and they do the same. So for us, we've set up the capability around doing it. We've invested a lot of money actually in developing tool sets and ways of making the process understandable. So the document that goes with it, I've got a copy of it, is quite dense and it's quite technical. So what we're trying to do is break it into bite-sized pieces so that as a consultant we can help rather than just be the next accountant. I don't see it being a massive work stream for us. The key thing for us is that our engineers become, if you like, well-ready. That they know how their practice as engineers should change, should consider new ideas. So one of the things, just on a very geeky mechanical engineering point of view, the well standard says that all of your cooling coils should have UV filtration.
Okay.
We would only normally do that in the UK in an operating theatre. So that's to stop noise growth from Germans building up cooling coils, because they're a site that happens. So our engineers now know that they should have space for it. Even for the project, we won't do it today, someone may come back later. So it's a little bit about priming people for it, and that for us is the biggest thing, so we can then go and talk to clients and architects and say, well, if you want to do that kind of project, we're ready. So I think this is probably my 20th lecture on well building standards in London.
But not a massive workshop.
At the moment it's early days. It's not sort of, you wouldn't want to set up business.
So is it in the US in terms of
US wise, I think it's too early. It was only launched last October. So there's a lot of projects just coming to market. But it's definitely, the momentum over there is much greater. And the clients that we're seeing here are mainly North American clients who've already become aware of it, and they want to know why they can or can't not do it in the UK. Is that analytics? The key markets are New York and California generally. And Toronto back here, we're pretty good.
Can I just ask, I don't think the Amazon is knocking on your door to certify their warehouses for well-being standards. I mean, that's sort of, you know, it's a cynical intro to main question really for you or for all of us. Because often when I listen to similar presentations, because the clients you're referring to are mainly either from a financial sector or from a creative industry.
Yep.
So, and this is not, as you said, this is not going to be a cheap standard. So if you're talking about global sustainability, I have a feeling that we are sort of creating that built environment in has its share of responsibility or should look within themselves. Are we creating a two-tier society? Because on one end, we are really discussing nitty-gritty on how this built environment truly influence the well-being of not that bad of people to start with.
No,
on the other hand, so what do we do with regulations and the building standard? That's really a question for you. On the Amazon warehouse and the organizations who simply, they can still make a lot of money, they influence our life, we kind of use them, but on the other hand, they do nothing but very contrary to well-being to their
There's two things I'd say to that. The first one is, I've often asked people the question myself, you know, what would a well building look like in rural India? And it won't be performing to these standards, but you'd be using the same framework of those concepts. So big issues in how's people cooking on a stove, burning whatever they can to eat their food, in enclosed environments, terrible problems in lockdown. In America, you find that this idea of health improvement districts, where you take some of this framework, you talk about people's access to food. You've got, you know, fresh food deserts in our cities, where people cannot get access to fresh fruit and vegetables. They can get canned, dosed in sugar, salt, all the rest of it. They cannot get access to fresh fruit. So I don't think the World Building Standard excludes us getting involved in that. What it does is it equips all of us with a better set of questions to ask. So when we're doing that next project for an Amazon or whoever, why aren't we? If we are, as I said earlier, public health professionals, it's our responsibility to say, if you would do this in your head office, why wouldn't you do it here? But the second thing is I worked on it for a footwear manufacturer with a major, very similar kind of Amazon-type facility in Belgium. We didn't win the project, but we were taking over the facility, and they told me something very interesting. They said, look, all these people who are doing all this packaging stuff, they do it, we do it because you cannot, and probably never will be able to get a robot to do the level of manual sophistication that we need to get this to work. And actually, we prefer to have people do it. And they said, think about it, those people that used to be in the back of the shop fetching those shoes for you, they're actually here, because the order goes in from the shop the day before, it arrives already on the tag, done. The employment hasn't disappeared from the high street, it's just moved into a factory environment. The problem they then have is performance and productivity. If you have staff who are doing the regular check, biking, and they're in situations with bad air, bad daylight, so on, their sick leave goes up, their performance drops rapidly, and you don't have a technological solution to it. So your staff become your critical point of weakness. So Amazon, yes, now, they have got these situations where people are working in not the best environments for their welfare. But a lot of people in a similar sector are starting to see, what can I do to make sure those staff who are doing that for 3 or 4 hours at a time, what happens in the space between shifts? What happens in terms of their access to data? Are they coming to work on a bike? Are they having good nature around them? A lot of the same questions. So there's huge scope to make those environments better. We should all be making the case for it.
Ed again for coming in today and talking about something that's very interesting and very different perspective from what I've been doing at IEDE. And just to contribute to everybody's well-being, there's a wine reception upstairs as well, so please feel free to join us for some more chats.